الحمد لله الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله الذي خلق السماوات والأرض وجعل الظلمات والنور الحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا الحمد لله الواحد الأحد الصمد الذي لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا مولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين يا رب صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم أما بعد فيا أيها الناس إني أوصيكم ونفسي أولا بتقوى الله والمواظبة على ذكر الله ألا خير الكلام كلام الله وأحسن الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وسثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار من أطاع الله ورسوله فقد رشد ومن يعص الله ورسوله فقد خسر وغواه فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون وقال تبارك وتعالى ألف لام ميم ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين وقال تبارك وتعالى فإن آمنوا بمثل ما آمنتم به فقد اهتدوا. We begin with the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We acknowledge that all praise and thanks belong to Him alone. Therefore we seek His guidance, we seek His assistance, we seek His forgiveness, we seek His love and His nearness. I put our complete trust and reliance in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. I bear witness that there's no being worthy of serving, worthy of observing, worthy of worship. And I bear witness that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the last and final messenger. When we study the Quran al-Kareem, and we look at the recurrence, the moral behind every guidance, the purpose behind every single parable that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran. Something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens the Quran with is guidance and hidayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Fatiha teaching us the method of supplicating to Him and teaching us what to ask for. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ, that we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guidance to the straight path. Not any path, the straight path. Sirat al-ladina an'amta alayhim. The path of those that favored. In Surah Al-Fatiha, when we make this dua, in the very next surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Alif lam mim, dhalika al-kitabu la rayba fihi, hudan lil-muttaqin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that this book that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with, the Quran al-Kareem, there's no doubt in it. There's no error in it. It is guidance. The guidance that we ask for, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the Quran al-Kareem is that has that guidance. Further on, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us an example. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, فَإِنْ آمَنُوا بِمِثْلِ مَا آمَنْتُمْ بِهِ فَقَدْ اِهْتَدَوْ. If you bring iman, if you brought iman, فَقَدْ اِهْتَدَوْ, then they are guided. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba that if the others bring iman, just as all of you have brought iman, then they are on guidance. And we look at the pronoun that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses here, آمَنْتُمْ بِهِ. Not just the iman of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but the iman of the Sahaba as well. That means that in order to follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we need to follow the Sahaba, because the Sahaba were the first companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They were the ones who were the first ones to follow the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They were the first ones to implement the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the way shown to us by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they are our examples. If we want to bring iman, we want to follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, We need to look at the lives of the Sahaba. We need to look and study at the lives of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Derive lessons from their lives and emulate them. In doing so, we will follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we will get the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells in the Quran, وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنصَارِ وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that the سَابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ, the first group of those who accepted Islam, the front runners, the ones who accepted Islam early on, the Sahaba of Makkah al-Mukarramah, وَالْأَنصَارِ, and the helpers, the companions from Madinatul Munawwarah, وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانٍ, and those who make their irtiba, those who follow them in doing good, رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with them. If we want to attain the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we want to attain the rada, the happiness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one avenue in doing so is emulating the Sahaba in the good that they did. Now, how do we know the lives of the Sahaba? How can we derive the lessons from the Sahaba's lives? We need to study their lives. I want to share one hadith of the Prophet, a hadith that many of us are already familiar with. We often hear it at the end of the Jummah Khutbah. And that is where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, أَرْحَمُ أُمَّتِي بِأُمَّتِي أَبُو بَكْرٍ وَأَشَدُّهُمْ فِي أَمْرِ اللَّهِ عُمَرٍ وَأَزْدَقُهُمْ حَيَاءً عُثْمَانٍ وَقَضَاهُمْ عَلِيٍّ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he highlighted a couple traits of some of the major Sahaba. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, أَرْحَمُ أُمَّتِي بِأُمَّتِي أَبُو بَكْرٍ, the most compassionate from my followers towards my followers is Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. وَأَشَدُّهُمْ فِي أَمْرِ اللَّهِ عُمَرٍ, the most stern in following the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Umar. وَأَشَدُّ عُمَرْ وَأَصْدَقُهُمْ حَيَاءً عُثْمَانٍ, and the most truthful in haya, in modesty, is Uthman radiallahu anhu. وَقَضَاهُمْ عَلِيٍّ, and the most just from amongst them is Ali radiallahu anhu. So these are four traits of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam himself highlighted. The first one of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, أَرْحَمُ أُمَّتِي بِأُمَّتِي أَبُو بَكْرٍ, the most compassionate from my ummah, from my followers, towards my followers, is Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. The days, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam's era in Makkah al-Mukarramah was a very hard time. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the Sahaba, they went through test after test. And one of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam's greatest helpers, the one who was there from day one supporting the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, was Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu during this time is, we know the story of Bilal radiallahu anhu. Bilal radiallahu anhu was a slave, and he was also one of the early Sahaba who accepted Islam. And when his owner found out about Islam, his owner put him out of test, we know, on hot sand in the summer in the deserts of Makkah al-Mukarramah with a hot stone on top, punishing him just for believing in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the finality of the Prophethood of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he did whatever he could to protect the followers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What did he do when he heard about this? He sent one of his messengers to go to the owner of Bilal radiallahu anhu and ask how much he would sell Bilal radiallahu anhu for. The owner was Umayyah bin Khalaf. And when he heard that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu wants to buy Bilal radiallahu anhu, he scoffed and said, yeah, just give me 7 silver coins. So the messenger gave it to him. And he said that, why are you paying this much for him? The messenger of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, who Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu had sent, he said that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was willing to pay 100 silver coins. And this was out of his compassion for those who believe in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the prophethood of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the compassion of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu did not stop there. It wasn't restricted to Bilal radiallahu anhu. The narrations mention that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, just in the Meccan era, the 13 years in Mecca, of 35,000 gold coins in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we do the math today, that's in the millions. This was not for his personal benefit. This was Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu spending in the causes that please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To help others, to feed others, to free others. This was the compassion of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. When the father of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu heard about Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu spending money to free Bilal radiallahu anhu, at that time he wasn't a Muslim yet. And he said that, why don't you invest in those people that can benefit you? Why would you go to a weak slave who is being punished? Why don't you get someone who's strong, who's healthy, someone who can help you? Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he said that, I do not seek any personal benefit. This is not to benefit me. This is to benefit the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And just him saying this resulted in revelation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَسَيُجَنَّبُهَا الْأَتْقَى الَّذِي يُؤْتِي مَالَهُ يَتَزَكَّى وَمَا لِأَحَدٍ عِنْدَهُ مِنْ نِعْمَةٍ تُجْزَى إِلَّا ابْتِغَاءَ وَجْهِ رَبِّهِ الْأَعْلَى وَلَسَوْفَ يَرْضَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَسَيُجَنَّبُهَا الْأَتْقَى. This was right after Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu's statement. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَسَيْجَنَّبُهَا الْأَتْقَى. And save from it, the punishment of Jahannam, are those who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those who have taqwa. الَّذِي يُؤْتِي مَا لَهُ يَتَزَكَّى. The one who gives his wealth. He gives his wealth in charity to purify himself. وَمَا لِأَحَدٍ عِنْدَهُ مِنْ نِعْمَةٍ تُجْزَى. And he does not want any favor from those who he's giving to. إِلَّا بَتِغَاءَ وَجْهِ رَبِّهِ الْأَعْلَى. The pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَسَوْفَ يَرْضَى. And surely he will soon be happy. This was the sincerity of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. His compassion was sincere. And this was verified by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this was the first trait that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned, "Arhamu ummati bi ummati Abu Bakr, wa ashadduhum fi amrillahi Umar." The most severe of them concerning the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the amr, the order of Allah. Now let's pause here for a second and think about this. When it came to others, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was compassionate. When it came to individually following the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the most severe. And this is a lesson for us, is that we need to have our priorities straight. That when it comes to our own situation, our own ibadah, our own iman, our own dealings, we need to be stern. Make sure that we do not stray from the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when it comes to dealing with others, when it comes to respecting others, the rights of others, we need to show compassion. We have our tables turned today. That when it comes to ourselves, we need to be loose. We need to find all of the excuses and all of the luxuries. But others, no, everything has to be right. But we learn from the Sahaba that when it comes to individual connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, We need to be the sternest. And when it comes to our dealings with others, we need to be compassionate. So Umar radiallahu anhu, when it came to following the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he was the most stern. He was the most severe. And one beautiful example of this is when we look at the time when Umar radiallahu anhu was commissioned as the Khalifa. And the discussion was about we look at what he asked for. He asked for a couple things. He asked for a conveyance so that he may perform Hajj and Umrah. He asked for two sets of clothes, one for the winter time, one for the summer time. And he asked for enough food to fulfill the hunger, for his hunger and the hunger of his family. Umar radiallahu anhu, the one under whose khilafah he conquered. Someone who, during his time, a lot was done for Islam. But what did he ask for in fulfilling the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He asked for the absolute minimum. One conveyance, two pairs of clothes, one for winter, one for summer, and just enough food to get by. And this, once again, his clothes. The Sahaba mentioned that the clothes of Umar radiallahu anhu and his family were coarse. His clothes were not comfortable. But he ensured that the people under his rule, they have proper clothes to wear. A beautiful example of this is during his khilafah, the ruler of Yemen sent a lot of clothes. And it was almost as if the people of Madinatul Munawwara were wearing a uniform. But the two Sahaba did not get a size that fit them. They were none other than the grandsons of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Hassan and Hussein radiallahu anhuma. Umar radiallahu anhu did not sit still until he ensured that these two, the grandsons of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Hassan and Hussein radiallahu anhuma, also received their share. He wrote a letter to the leader of Yemen that please send something for these two as well. But Hassan radiallahu anhu says that once while Umar radiallahu anhu was giving a khutbah, I counted 12 patches on his clothes. Right? So when it came to them fulfilling the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they were stern. But for self-benefit, Umar radiallahu anhu, he did not take any luxuries. He did whatever he could so that he can please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he's not questioned. One more story about his time that shows how much he would go through, what lengths he went through to ensure he does not disobey the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The narrations say that it was a hot summer day. And Umar radiallahu anhu was in the desert, away from any civilization. And when the companions found out about this, they asked him, what are you doing? It's hot, what are you looking for? He says that one camel from the sadaqah ran away, so I went to look for it. They said that you have people under you. Why don't you send one of those in charge of the Baytul Mal? Send somebody under you. Umar radiallahu anhu said that the heat of the summer is cooler than the fire of the hellfire. He did not want to be questioned. He did not want to be questioned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala under his control, and he himself did the best he could. This was the second one. وَأَشْهَدُوا فِي أَمْرِ اللَّهِ عُمَرٍ. The third one that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَأَصْدَقُهُمْ حَيَاءً عُثْمَانٍ. The most truly modest of them is Uthman radiallahu anhu. Haya is a very important commodity, a very important quality that unfortunately is rare today. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that إِذَا فَاتَكَ الْحَيَاء, if you do whatever you want. And the scholars of hadith explain that the person who does not have haya, they do not practice haya, their destruction is imminent. Haya, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the story is mentioned in the hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was one day sitting, and the portion just above his ankles were showing. And he was leaning back. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, Umar radiallahu anhu were sitting there. In, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put his clothes down, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he fixed his posture. Now the Sahaba asked him, why are you showing modesty in front of Uthman radiallahu anhu? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, why should I not show modesty in front of the one who the Malaika show modesty in front of? Now what is the modesty of Uthman radiallahu anhu? It is said about Uthman radiallahu anhu that from the day he gave out his right hand to pledge allegiance to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and accept Islam, he did not touch his private parts with his right hand. Uthman radiallahu anhu would go through lengths to ensure that he was following through and acting upon the haya and modesty. And what is haya? If you look at the definitions of haya, one of them is that we should not find ourselves in those places that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prohibited us from. We should not be in those circumstances and situations where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prohibited. Now if you look, we should remind ourselves of haya, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want us here. If we find ourselves in a business dealing that involves some haram, then we should remind ourselves, this is also haya. There is haya of clothing and modesty and looking, but there's also haya in our dealings. There's also haya in our transactions and the way we live our lives. So this is the third quality that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam highlighted, wa azdaqhum haya an Uthman. And finally he said, wa aqdahum Ali. The best judge is Ali radiallahu anhu. The ability to make effective decisions is a priceless commodity. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam one day, he commanded Ali radiallahu anhu to judge and rule over the people of Yemen. So Ali radiallahu anhu says that, I am junior, there are seniors living there, and I don't think I can pass judgments in a proper manner. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he put his hand on the chest of Ali radiallahu anhu, and he made dua for Ali radiallahu anhu, and he gave him a few advices. One of the advices that he gave him was that before passing judgment, listen to the entire story of the second party. Do not just listen to one side. And this is a lesson for us, is that whenever we go out to do something, we should contemplate the outcomes. We should look at the complete scenario. We should look at the whole situation before completing anything. Before doing anything, we need to look at all of the outcomes. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instill within us these beautiful qualities and traits of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu had. And this the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, عَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِّينَ. That is my sunnah and the sunnah of the Khulafa'i Rashideen, the ones who are guided. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst them, those who bring the qualities of the Prophet, the Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam into our lives, and he make us from amongst those who follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and those who enjoy the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد عبدك ورسولك وصل على المؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات وبارك على محمد وأزواجه وذريته. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: أرحم أمتي بأمتي أبو بكر، وأشدهم في أمر الله عمر، وأرزقهم حياء عثمان، وأقضاهم علي، وفاطمة سيدة نساء أهل الجنة، والحسن والحسين سيدا شباب أهل الجنة، وحمزة أسد الله وأسد رسوله. اللهم اغفر للعباس ولده مغفرة ظاهرة وباطنة لا تغادر ذنبا. اللهم أعنا على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. Oh Allah, help us in remembering you and allow us to worship you in the best of manners. اللهم ارزقنا حبك. Oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, bless us with your love. وحب من يحبك, and the love of those who love you. وحب العمل الذي يقربنا إلى حبك, and the love for those things that bring us closer to your love. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة. Oh Lord, give us good in this world, وفي الآخرة حسنة, and goodness in the hereafter. وقنا عذاب النار, and protect us from the fire of Jahannam. اللهم اشف مرضانا. Oh Allah, give shifa and cure to all of those who are sick. وارحم موتانا, and have mercy on those who have passed away. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمدا رسول الله. هي الصلاة هي الصلاة هي الصلاة هي الصلاة. إقامة الصلاة إقامة الصلاة. الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين, الرحمن الرحيم, مالك يوم الدين, إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. محمد رسول الله, والذين معه أشداء على الكفار رحماء بينهم, تراهم ركعا سجدا يبتغون فضلا من الله ورضوانا, سيماهم في وجوههم من أثر السجود, ذلك مثلهم في التوراة, ومثلهم في الإنجيل كزرع أخرج شطأه فآزره فاستغلظ فاستوى على سوقه يعجب الزرع ليغيظ بهم الكفار, وعد الله الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات منهم مغفرة وأجرا عظيما. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين, مالك يوم الدين, إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. قل هو الله أحد الله يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. اللهم بارك عظيم سلطانك. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.
Are recorded and also available on the Facebook and IIT Torrance